Alright, so the autofocus should have been fixed there. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is with each area, so like around here, you know, making a painting more realistic isn't in particular, you don't have to do anything different than what you've seen me do here. It's just now we're just going to be adding much more nuance to these shapes. A little lighter there. And for me, I'm trying to make it more realistic, but I still want to maintain the strength of the painting at a distance. So the challenge for me is to get into the smaller shapes now without losing track of the larger shapes. That's going to be the challenge. All right, so let's get you into a close-up shot. So now the colors that we're going to add or subtract or take off, basically, they're not going to be that complicated. So for this part of the painting, I'm going to try to, I'm going to do the best that I can to push the realism. So this is going to require me to focus quite a bit more. So as a result, I may end up being a little more quiet. But I'll still once in a while, say, like, for instance, I'm going to try to get a little more light for the sclera over here. See that? With a single touch. And I'm going to have to keep moving around the shapes like this. Like I said, trying to push the painting more realistic. You don't have to do anything special, anything different. Just relating all these shapes to one another and just start to subdivide the shapes. And that's it. I mean, of course, easier said than done, so a little bit of ivory black and alizarin permanent. I'm going to look again at this corner. I'm going to use the fan brush to eliminate the glare. Now, each one of these shapes, it's going to have a very, very specific boundary. And my only limitation in terms of the size of the shape that I can work on is basically going to be the brushes that I'm going to use. And yes, I know, I need to get some more brushes. But this is why I use synthetics again. So in this part of the painting in particular, I'm going to really want to rely on the synthetics just because I don't need that much paint anymore. The amount of paint I have on there is fine. I don't need to add like a more impasto paint or anything, but what I need now is to be able to fine tune each one of these shapes. And there's a little glimpse of the light right over here that I can't quite get with the brush that I have. And I just think that it's the, I think I just need a very tiny brush for this. Let's do the best that we can to paint this shape in there. It's getting a little better. So now the eye is starting to look more and more realistic. This is also going to be a test at, just how far can we go with this technique? How realistic can we make things? In particular, since, I haven't been using that Umber sketch. I haven't been using any outlines or any transfers. So this is all paint. That's pretty fun to see what we can do in this way. So right around here is going to be another plane change. There's going to be a much more subtle gradation here now. A little bit more alizarin permanent. Again, alizarin permanent is the MVP for these flesh colors. And just trying to work these planes. I think that here is a little bit more of a plane, like a chop, that I didn't really see before. Now that I'm getting into these smaller shapes, I can perceive it a little better. So I'll tell you what, flake white is definitely the white that you want to use in these kind of very subtle value gradations. So right now it's just flake white and the alizarin crimson permanent. And see how with each little passage, starting to get more and more refined. And that's all. You just have to keep observing the shapes. And now, especially with the nose, so again, the alizarin crimson permanent, you want to look at volumes. And in particular, there's going to be much more volume here. So it's getting darker as the plane is turning away. So let's see right over here. And then of course, there's gonna be if I can even find a brush for this, there's gonna be a lighter plane right next to that shape we just established. So off camera here, I'm just cleaning off another little brush. And flake white into the lighter region of the flesh tones right here. And right after cleaning a brush, again, I really like to jump into the flake white just so that I can charge the paint brush again with more paint. So now we have that plane. And now it's going to get even more subtle, and yep, you guessed it. I'm going to be using again the alizarin crimson permanent, but this time with a little bit of cadmium green. Don't worry, I'm going to switch you back to the shot where you can see the palette soon. So again, I really want to push the volume, or the volumes in this painting. So by understanding volumes, you can also create a much more, a much more realistic image. So for instance, what I mean about volume is right here. So here's an example of volume. So for the bulb of the nose, pushing the darks around this right here. So notice how I'm pushing the darks around here. Pushing these darks darker is actually elevating these planes, making these planes look lighter. You see that? See how we're starting to get more curvature now for the bulb of the nose. And again, when you're trying to make something more and more realistic, it's going to help you to pay lots of attention to the shadow shapes, the nature of the shadow shapes. How exacting can you make the shadow shapes? And for me, it's really about trying to get this curve here for the nostril. So basically the nostril right around here is also a contour. It's also basically the contour for the wing of the nose right around here. And so again, you want to look at the boundaries of the forms. So for instance, the wing of the nose, if I can get the right value. So the wing of the nose is going to start here. So the boundary of the form is going to be illustrating the shape of the form. So right here, we're actually describing the boundary of the wing of the nose right around here. One of my teachers, John DeMartin, would call it the base boundary, which would be the shape of the form as he would describe it. So right around here. So I'm thinking of just this very simple mapping now of the wing of the nose, looking at the topography of it. Bet you didn't think that we could get this specific, at least this kind of specificity with this technique. We still have a long way to go. So again, the boundary is getting a little lost here. So let me go ahead and put that shape in there. There we go. Sometimes that'll happen, just like little magical brush strokes. And of course, cannot forget the highlight, but I think I'm going to switch you back to the normal view. All right, so here we are back in the normal view of the painting demonstration. So now for the highlight, I actually did just clean off this brush a little bit with my Odorless mineral spirits, and I like to jump right into my flake white just to add more paint onto the brush. And I want the highlight to be, I want it to be a little cooler, so let's just throw this in there. Just whatever, something that's cooler. And then ultimately the titanium white. Just throw in that highlight. And a highlight is more than just a dot. The highlight should have some kind of shape to it as well. So this is more of like a rectangular looking shape. But nonetheless, it's a very bright highlight, so I can't really ignore it. I am trying to get the shape of this highlight. And you know, I think it's a little more orangey, so let's mix right onto here. Just red and the yellows. A little bit more red. Even more red. All right, so now let's go ahead and reestablish that highlight. Kind of lost the boundary for the highlight. Okay, so now I think that the mouth is going to need some attention. So I'm just cleaning off the brush here. Hopefully I got the autofocus right. Yep, I did. Okay. So anyway, so now the mouth again. So I just cleaned off the brush again. So I'm going to go right back into my flake white just to recharge the palette and just mix all this up, or recharge the brush, that is. And let's go ahead and start to put in some more light here. And so I think that we're going to have to call out some reinforcements here. So I basically got all of the smaller brushes that I could find, but I didn't really use just because like this one kind of, I don't know, flimsy. But I just need to use brushes that are a little bit smaller now. So I'm going to put those onto the side. And so relevant question here. So mineral spirits, so E, I'm not really sure how to say this one, I'm sorry, is asking mineral spirits, which is safest? My thing's not auto-focusing, but okay. So that's kind of relevant just because I'm going to be cleaning off some of these brushes here as I talk about this. So I did see that some of you responded to the comment about mineral spirits, which is safest and how to safely dispose of these rags. And I will say that I've heard of this this medium or brush cleaner called Spike Lavender. It is not odorless. It does smell like lavender. So if you don't like lavender, which I actually like the smell of lavender, it's kind of expensive. But as far as the safest, I've heard that Spike Lavender is good. The other one that I've used I haven't been using recently, just because someone wrote a comment about not knowing if the something about it. But anyway, the other one you could use that allegedly is safer is citrus essence. So if you just like look up non-toxic brush cleaners for oil paints, Spike Lavender, and then you have a citrus essence will show up. The one that I'm using is just Mona Lisa. So that's how I'm cleaning off the brushes right now. So since I'm going to introduce a whole bunch of other brushes, I might as well start cleaning off these brushes. The larger ones with like the background tone and stuff, I'm just going to keep these on the side because I'm probably going to end up using them. But this large flesh tone brush, I don't really think I'm going to use it. I might, but I'm just going to clean it off. So again, I use Mona Lisa Mineral Spirits. I hear that Gamsol might be a little bit, I don't know, Gamsol Mineral Spirits might be a little bit higher quality, but I think it's doing just fine. I'm doing just fine with the cheaper Mona Lisa one. All right, so that ought to do it with cleaning the brushes. So now I'm just going to get some of these smaller brushes on the side here. So I don't know. Let's work with these three for now. And I may throw in some extras later. So again, the flesh tones that I'm going to mix are not going to be that complicated. I'm just going to be taking right off the palette for the majority of these colors. So now let's go ahead and look at this shape here. So that goes all the way down towards here. There. So the nice thing about this technique, this wet on wet technique, is you know, if you see a mistake, if you spot something, you know, as opposed to with the underpainting and the transfer drawing approach, you just part of the process, you know, the editing, the correcting is just built into it. So just by the very nature that we're working by adding on these shapes to one another, even though we introduce much more awkwardness, I think, to the you know, the development of the painting, I think it just makes it a little bit more user-friendly. And again, I'm saying all this knowing that I am going to use the classical approach in the future, because I do. That's the approach that I'm using for that larger painting that you saw the start of. And yes, you will receive updates on that video at some point in the future. But yes, I do use the classical approach still. It's just that for, I don't know, for me lately, just personally, this technique I really like. Just being able to, you know, just push the paint wherever I want it to go. It's very malleable, very flexible, very forgiving. Now, with these extra brushes that I'm using, I'm trying to keep track of which is a light one, a middle one, a dark one. Oh, and by the way, these are, what are these? Plaza Montgomery Synthetic Rounds. These are size 0 rounds. These are actually brushes that I deemed kind of unusable before. But now I really need a smaller touch. So I think they're working just fine, though. I think I was just being picky when I deemed them unusable. Another thing I like about synthetics is that they're very inexpensive. These synthetics are much cheaper than their bristle counterparts. The reason I've been using a lot more bristle these days is, you know me, I get brushes when they're on sale, and there was a really amazing sale on these bristle brushes, and I bought like a whole section at the Hobby Lobby store. I know, I don't like the name of the store either, but can't beat the sales. But now that my bristles are starting to die on me, I don't know what I'm going to do. Anyway, I'm just pushing more and more subtlety into these shapes. Whereas I had that angle like too far down, now it's a little more straight. And then while I'm doing that, I can also put in this shape. Goes a little bit inwards like this. And just soften the edges around it. I think I just messed that up there. So I'm going to get the, I don't even know. I think this is the light brush. So this brush that I already had in hand, just adding a little more light to it. And I'm looking for planes, whereas that looked like a line to me before. Now I'm just going to see it in terms of a subdivision of planes. Another thing I should talk about as I'm adding on the paint. So I'm painting on an acrylic toned canvas, just because, just like last time, I didn't really give myself time to oil tone my canvases. But much to my surprise, I'm not really having too much of a problem painting on this surface. Gonna get another brush. So this flat one here, I'm gonna I'm going to let this be my designated shadow brush. Just because I'll know it's a different brush because it's flat and looks different. I hope you like that I'm bringing you along for the journey here. I'm bringing you along the ride to the development of this painting and, you know, the past few paintings that I've done already. Again, I'm showing you every single brushstroke. And I'm talking to you as I'm painting. You're as much a part of the development of this painting as I am. You're sitting there, you're watching me develop the painting, you're listening to me. It's like we're connected. We're developing this painting together. So, right there, I just obliterated this shape here, just because there's a little more of a top plane here that I haven't adequately described. So, I'm going to add more light onto this brush. So it's very important that I get this plane. I think that this plane here is going to be a very important. It's going to be very descriptive for the nature of our model's mouth. Let's see here. Let's add a little bit of green, so sap green down here. And right now I'm looking for the boundary of the form. So what is the shape of the form essentially? So here, here, there. It's going to be angling up in that fashion. And then it's going to get much darker here. And again, I'm not trying to create a perfect photographic rendition of the model, but I am trying to stay as true to the shapes as I can. And if I make a mistake, if it looks different than in the photo reference, oh well. It's a painting. We're enjoying the process of creating the painting. That's what's most important. It's a little bit of a darker shape there. Almost went off camera, but I think you can see that shape all the way down here. Okay, so this shape needs even more specificity, and I think it's that I need to put in more light. So a little more light right into here. I need to remember which is the light brush. So the one with the tape, we're going to call this the light brush because it has the light tape. And I think that's why I even put that tape there in the past. Now we're describing those lights. And I think that this is still kind of a little bit vaporous. Vaporous, meaning it just doesn't have much structure to it yet. So let's go ahead and put that dark shape in there. Very simple and clean plane change. And now the shadow brush, that flat brush. I'm gonna see if I can create an accent mark with it. There we go. And all into here. And remember, the accent is the where one form, so the upper lip meets the lower lip, closes off quite a bit of light, looks really dark to us, and then therefore that is an accent. And that's all. It's going to be a little pink around there. I can't ignore that there is some pink there. So let's see here. The cadmium red medium and the flake white. And hopefully it won't look too red. Going to let it mix with the flesh tone that's already on the canvas. So that ought to work. And then the side plane of the orbicularis oris, so right here, it's a little more flat than I had it before. And then, of course, let's add some light. So this is the stuff that I would cut out. Like in my older portrait painting tutorials, the way I was able to keep them like an hour long was by cutting out stuff like, that I didn't think anyone would want to watch. And now I'm showing you everything, even the stuff that I don't think anyone's going to want to watch. So if you're sitting there watching, you know, all of this subtlety here that I'm starting to add, thank you. So even all in the nose, I feel like, I'm going to want to put in more information, but I'm still trying to develop these structures around here. And, you know, if realism is what you're after, if you want your paintings to look more realistic, this is how you do it. Just observing each plane at a time. You must think structurally. You know, I'm not looking at each shape. Like, I'm not looking at the photo reference and trying to figure out what color this is or what exact, you know, shape the photo reference is. Rather, I'm thinking of, you know, this is a person in three-dimensional space, and I'm not trying to think of what exact angle is this plane making with respect to the light. The photo reference is just there as a reference. I'm not trying to copy it. Now with the shadow brush, I think I accidentally took this shape out. So I'm going to have to put it back very delicately. Again, all of this is a very, very subtle light, halftone, dark, light again, dark, very dark, light. See how it's just, you know, forms or overlapping forms? I really have to squint down now. Squint to see value, blur your eyes to see color. Whereas at first we were looking for those colors, remember? I was saying that I was trying to, you know, paint what I saw when my eyes were blurred. Now I'm trying to paint what I see when my eyes are squinting.